I'm going to talk with about four little modules. One an anecdote on a personal anecdote, creating a new and old San Francisco. I love that title. The second, a little bit about the epidemic of age-related cognitive impairment, stating what the problem is and why it is such a disaster. A little bit about the science around this and some of the very palpable solutions that people in this room can make happen today. And then a few words about the Memory and Aging Center and the Global Brain Health Institute, which I'm so proud and so lucky to be part of. So, San Francisco, I've been here 20 years, but it's been part of my brain for a very long time. And I was a very alienated, I think a little bit restricted in vision teenager, brought up in Madison, Wisconsin, and started to see some of the pictures of Haight-Ashbury when I was about 15. And it was very inspiring to me. And my parents, in a brief lapse of sanity, and they were very sane people. And in fact, my mom at 92 still inspires me. But they did have this brief lapse of sanity when I was 17 and allowed my brother and I to drive our family's Bonneville convertible V8 across the country to visit the West. And we drove through the desert up California, eventually Vancouver. For me, this was inspiring. It shaped my entire life. I knew I wanted to come back to those places because there were people in that like people in the audience today, who had a better vision, less parochial, more creative, more inspiring. And so this is the San Francisco that I imagined when I came here 20 years ago. I felt that inspiration. It's true, it's real. And I think the people here want to make this the most exciting, vibrant place in the world to age. And I think one of the opportunities of the Global Brain Health Institute is to make this the most exciting city, along with Dublin, in the world for elders that inspires places across the world. So epidemic, it's a huge one. Michael Hurd had a wonderful paper from Rand Institute, where he pointed out that age-related cognitive impairment is the most costly health problem in the United States, much more costly than cancer, stroke, heart disease, all of which are starting to show solutions that are dropping the prevalence, and that is not the case with age-related cognitive impairment continuing to rise. This is, I think, a massive problem, and I think I'm speaking to the choir here, but I would say, for me, there have been no more important people in my life than elders, and I think that one of the things that, as a neurologist, a biologist, I think about is the increase in wisdom, altruism, that experience derives for people as they age. So we have this unbelievably, and Carol touched on this, valuable cohort of people that have a huge contribution to make to our societies. The wisdom circuits are getting stronger, more highly connected. Data is really clear that we elders are a more altruistic group than the young. And we even study that in the laboratory. But I think that the biggest threat to this important cohort that, as Josh Kornbluth would say, will save the world, is the superimposition of this wisdom with cognitive disorder. So this is the problem, $200 billion a year at least, growing. It hurts in particular low-income populations. It hurts countries where there are lack of interventions around brain protection. So this is an epidemic in the United States. Many of you know that in the Mission area, parts of San Francisco where people may not get the typical care that the people in this room do, it's even a bigger problem. We know that by 2035, we will see a doubling of the dementia across the world. This in this country, two times, places like China, India, Brazil, parts of South America, tripling. So I think this is affecting a city like San Francisco, wealthy people, middle class people, but really gonna have an impact on the poor. What happens? I think one of the exciting things that we have learned over the past 5 to 10 years is that about 30% of this epidemic is preventable. Unbelievable to think that we have 5 to 6 million people who are diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease every year. Imagine the difference in our society if these preventable risk factors were instituted in our systems, whether it's social work, physical therapy, nutrition. This is just an incredible catastrophe. So what are these preventable risk factors? I think it's pretty clear: cardiovascular risks, high blood pressure, hypertension, high cholesterol, lack of exercise. These are all very significant risk factors, seem to be particularly prevalent in low-income parts of our city. Other things that I think increasingly are evident is that loneliness, isolation, depression, head trauma, high stress are also incredibly powerful risks for developing cognitive disorders as well. These are the low-hanging fruit. These are the things that we think that we can institute in this new old San Francisco that will change the quality of life for elders and the younger people that elders touch. And this is one of the big goals of Dominic and Global Brain Health Institute as well. What happens in the brain with these diseases? I think UCSF has been a place where Stan Prusner, a Nobel laureate, showed that what happens is that as we age, we are more likely to aggregate bad proteins in the brain. They start in a single cell, spread out along a circuit, cause progressive and eventually irreversible damage to specific circuits. If it's the Alzheimer proteins, you see problems with memory circuits. If it's a disease that I study, frontotemporal dementia, you see the erosion of moral thinking, social cognition, empathy for other people. If it's Parkinson's-related proteins, you see changes in movement, profound disorders of sleep. So these proteins are different. We all have different vulnerabilities to these proteins, and there are these preventable risk factors that we can institute today in San Francisco that will diminish the likelihood that all of us and the people in our city will develop these disorders of protein aggregation. That's the 30%. What about the 70%? Well, I think we are seeing a neuroscience explosion in this city, across the world. People really beginning to think about ways of preventing those proteins from misfolding, from aggregating, from destroying these critical circuits in the brain. I think we have been very myopic in science and the way we've thought about this. But I think for the first time, I have great hope that in addition to these preventive measures that we are going to think about today, there are also going to be medications that we can take in the space of brain protection. Okay, Memory and Aging Center, I came here really blessed 20 years ago. It's the anniversary of 20th anniversary of the Memory and Aging Center. We have focused on giving model care to people in our city and beyond our city. We do research, we do education, we do outreach. I think I'm very proud of the people that have come here. I think they're a little bit like me. They come from all different places. Our MacArthur Genius Award, Bill Seeley, came from rural Michigan. But something in his brain drove him into this incredible environment here. And that is the environment that I now live in every day. And it is inspiring. And when I go away for a week, I come back and am inspired by the new discoveries that are going on by our scientists, by other scientists. Last thing I want to say a little bit about is the Global Brain Health Institute. This is something that was started by Ian Roberts and I, pushed, inspired by Chris Exley of Atlantic Institutes. I'm not necessarily supposed to say it, but I'm going to say it. This is funded by a man named Chuck Feeney, who is the silent philanthropist. He believes you should give without worrying about credit. And just hearing about Chuck and hearing about the things he's done across the world, I think is inspiring to me and makes me a little better and purer. So Atlantic Philanthropies is funded seven programs across the world focused on health equity, fairness. The Global Brain Health Institute that is based in Dublin and in San Francisco is focused on interprofessional training. We train artists who we realize have a voice to our communities. One of the most important concepts of GBHI is dignifying the concept of elder. We think this is half the problem. If our politicians and our society understand how valuable elders are, they won't leave elders without health care, without the things that are needed to protect their health and their brain. We're also training incredible scientists a part of this. We have a motto, which is force, that all of the fellows are asked to embody. Fairness, openness, respect for elders, for people around them, and two that I'm particularly excited about, empathy and courage. And I think a lot about the circuitry of empathy. How can we develop this circuitry? How can we make it stronger in a society that seems to be diminishing in its empathy for the poorest people in our population? There has been a mantra since the Reagan era about the no need for a social blanket, government is bad, and of course we all know that's unbelievably ridiculous, and it leaves our most vulnerable people incredibly harmed. And I think we have really suffered, as Josh Kornbluth has taught me, a lack of empathy. Our whole society is diminishing in empathy. This is something that GBHI, we hope, will change. And I wondered if in the last minute or so, the GBHI fellows could just stand up and say in your elevator speech, this is part of leadership training, which is 30 seconds what you are doing as a GBHI fellow. We have 1 minute, so I'm gonna ask Josh and Alyssa, and that's all I can get to. Okay, Josh. Alyssa? Thank you. I'm going to end just with a last anecdote. So, Susan, so what a gracious talk. And I just have to ask people to forget one thing Susan said, that I'm a musician, okay? I mean, I think remembering is hard, forgetting is even sometimes harder. But this is also a minor miracle of GBHI that she even thinks I'm a musician or magician. But the story is this. One of our fellows, Heidi Clare, who brings music to the world, has a podcast that you should listen to where she talks with elder musicians like Country Joe, who swear a lot. A wonderful interview. But she started a memory and aging center band in which Josh Kornbluth and I sang at Hardly Strictly Bluegrass, and this was the awakening of a voice and a part of my brain that had been silent since the time I cried as a little baby. So anyways, that was a miracle of GBHI.
So